now, the greatest radio shows of all time.
Suspense.
The Shadow Node.
Washington calling David Harding, counter-spy.
Classic radio theater.
The Great Gildersleeve.
Fibber McGee and Molly.
Dragnet. Gunsmoke.
The Lone Ranger.
Now step back into our time machine with your host, Wyatt Cox.
Good evening, friends of the Inner Sanctum.
Well, you ready for some laughs this Monday? That's where we'll go with the Henry Morgan Show, also Bob Hope, and the Jack Benny program, Dennis Day also during this two-hour block, and Lum and Abner all coming up here. That's all coming up on this Monday, 19th day of February, 50th day of the year, 316 days remaining until we get to 2025. England and the Netherlands signed the Peace of Westminster on this date in 1674, ending the Third Anglo-Dutch War. A provision of the agreement transferred the Dutch colony of New Amsterdam to England, which renamed it New York. In Alabama on this date in 1807, former Vice President of the U.S. Aaron Burr arrested for treason. In Austin, Texas on this date in 1846, the newly formed Texas state government officially installed. The Republic of Texas government officially transferred power to the state of Texas government following Texas's annexation by the U.S. In 1878, the phonograph record patented by Thomas Edison. In this clip, he recites the first words he ever recorded on the phonograph.
The first words I spoke in the original phonograph. A little piece of practical poetry. Mary had a little lamb, its fleece was white as snow, and everywhere that Mary went, the lamb was sure to go.
Not the exact recording, but what he said. Thomas Edison patenting the phonograph on this date in 1878, and the world would never be the same. In 1881, Kansas became the first U.S. state to prohibit all alcoholic beverages. We had an attorney general by the name of Vern Miller who would go onto airplanes in different states that would fly over Kansas, and when they got over the state of Kansas, he would start arresting people for having alcoholic beverages. And so planes for a period of time had to stop serving beverages when they flew over Kansas. Of course, that didn't fly for long. Oh, did I say that? I did. In 1913, prizes included in Cracker Jack boxes for the first time. In 1953, Georgia approved the first literature censorship board in the U.S. In 1964, Paul Simon wrote The Sounds of Silence, the song which, in a year and a half, would catapult him and Art Garfunkel to stardom as Simon and Garfunkel. In 1968, National Educational Television, the predecessor to the public broadcasting system, debuted the children's television program Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. In 1986, the Soviet Union launched the Mir space station. After waiting 37 years, the Senate, and on this date in 1986, approved a treaty outlawing genocide. In 2001, an Oklahoma City bombing museum dedicated at the Oklahoma City National Memorial.
The legacy of this place is heroism and goodness. That is what we celebrate in this museum.
Oklahoma Governor Frank Keating, the center of memorial to those 168 people who died and more than 500 who were injured in the Oklahoma City bombing. Having covered that nationally, it was just a horrific incident. And to this day, we remember it well. In 2006, the Rolling Stones made the largest show open to the public of the world in Copacabana Beach in Rio de Janeiro. 1.3 million people went to the show. In 2008, Fidel Castro announced he would step down as Cuba's president after a half century in power. In 2010, the FBI concluded that Army scientist Bruce Ivins acted alone in the 2001 anthrax mailings that killed five people and formally closed the case. Among those passing away on this date in history, sports entrepreneur Charles O. Finley. His antics with the A's, the Philadelphia A's, the Kansas City A's, the Oakland A's, they were legendary. Communist leader Deng Xiaoping passing away on this date. The very delightful Grandpa Jones, country entertainer. Stanley Kramer, the film director. Singer Johnny Paycheck, actress Janet Blair, and To Kill a Mockingbird author Harper Lee, all passing away on this date in history. Now, among those born on this date in history, mathematician and astronomer Nicholas Copernicus, also actor Sir Cedric Hardwicke, actress Merle Oberon, musician Stan Kenton, his artistry and rhythm was amazing, actor Lee Marvin, activist Karen Silkwood, John William Minton, better known to the public as pro wrestler Big John Studd, and Austrian singer Falco, all born on this date in history.
Hi, this is Jeff Foxworthy. It is now time for the birthday announcements. The following people are now officially older than dirt.
Happy birthday number 84 to the legendary Smokey Robinson, not only a great singer, but a songwriter and lyricist. And in this clip, he talks about writing his first song.
Auditorium teacher, she played this melody on the piano. And she said, well, they used to call me William or Bill in school. She said, well, William, she said, I don't have any words for this, but I'm going to get some words for you to sing. And you're going to sing this at the beginning of the show and at the end of the show. So I asked her, I said, well, can I write some words for it? You know, because I thought I could and I liked it, you know. So she thought it was very amusing and very cute that I was 6 years old and I wanted to write some words for it. So she said, okay. And she let me. And so I did it. And I wrote the words for the song and I sang them at the beginning. And sang them at the end. And my mother was all proud. I never forget because when I went out at the end of the show and I went out, I was sitting in my mother's lap and she was crying because she was all proud and everything, you know. But that was my first attempt at trying to write a song and doing it.
Smokey Robinson, 84 years old today. Lou Christie, Lightning Strikes Again. I don't have falsetto that sounds good anymore. Yes, it did sound good at one point in time. Shut up. From The Martian and Dumb and Dumber, Jeffrey Daniels, 69 years old today. English singer Seal, Kissed by a Rose. Oh, wonderful music. Seal is 61 today. From Family Ties, Justine Bateman is 58. Got an Academy Award for Traffic and also was in The Usual Suspects. Benicio del Toro is 57 today. From Lost, Eric Lang is 51. From Seventh Heaven, Haley Duff, 39. Actress Victoria Justice is 31. From Gotham, David Mazouz is 23. And from Stranger Things, Millie Bobby Brown is 20. Those just a few of the people who celebrate the 19th day of February as their birthday. And if this happens to be your birthday...
Hi, we're the Four Freshmen, and we just want to say... Happy birthday to you!
Up next here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox on this Monday, an episode of The Henry Morgan Show from 77 years ago, February 19th, 1947. Keep it right here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. And if you've never heard Henry Morgan, be prepared to at least snicker. Hopefully you'll just outright laugh.
Know what COLORAD means? It stands for Control of Electromagnetic Radiation. Sounds pretty complicated if you're not an electronic engineer, and yet all you have to do is dial your AM radio to 640 or 1240 in the event of an enemy air attack. And thanks to COLORAD, you will continue to receive official information. Remember, in times of civil defense emergency, for official news and civil defense instructions, dial COLORAD at 640 or 1240 on your AM standard radio.
And if you think it was complicated to the public, you should imagine being at a radio station. The big old transmitters, it wasn't as easy just to flip a dial to go from whatever frequency you're operating on to either 640 or 1240. In some transmitters, you had to make major changes and do it in a heartbeat because that's sometimes how much, you know, these stations basically had 15 to 20 minutes to make the changes. And, you know, the engineer had to go out and do this and do that. And sometimes it would take 10 to 15 minutes just to make the changes, if you were lucky. Anyway, that's Conal Rad. Interesting information there. Now on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox, the fellow who was Fred Allen turned up to 11, Henry Morgan, 77 years ago. If you don't know much about Henry Morgan, I will tell you that there are a couple of books out there, and I'll look up the name of his autobiography. I want to say it's Here's Morgan, but here's what he would do. When he was in New York City, he had a sponsor, Adler's Shoes. And he would tell people to go in and ask for old man Adler and talk about Adler's elevator shoes. You know, if you need to be 3 inches taller, get Adler shoes. Why you need to be 3 inches taller, I don't know. But he would sarcastic, and Adler wanted to cancel until some of his stores pointed out that people were coming in and asking for old man Adler. And that's when he found out that Morgan had listeners. He really did. From 77 years ago, February 19th, 1947, an episode of The Henry Morgan Show here on Classic Radio Theater.
The Henry Morgan Show? Eversharp, manufacturers of Eversharp Chick injector razors and blades, brings you the Henry Morgan Show, featuring Bernie Green and his orchestra and a few surprises.
Good evening, anybody. Here's Morgan. Thank you.
Taxes! Taxes!
I've been looking at the national budget. All those expenses. Frankly, I don't see how I can pay for all that stuff. The government's putting money into reforestation, Indian reservations, fisheries, hatcheries. Some of that stuff I hardly ever use. So I have some ideas. I have some ideas on how we can save money. For instance, in this country, if a man wants to run for president, why don't we charge him an entry fee? Well, look at the money we'd collect every 4 years just from Albany. Run into... After all, Albany's the capital of New York State. That's if you're from out of town. After all, in this country, being president is the dream of every Tom, Dick, and... I'm sure of Tom, anyway. Another thing, maybe we're spending too much for congressmen. After all, do you realize that we have, 400-odd congressmen, and some of them are, but... Besides, they're absent much of the time, and I think every time a congressman is absent, he should pay a fine. You realize I would keep him on the job all the time, using every bit of his ability, all his brain power, maybe better leave it the way it is. Well, I have a lot of ideas like that, and while I'm trying to forget them, here's an unusual guy. His name is Rector Bailey, and he plays the guitar. And while that's going on, he sings a song that he picked up in Haiti. It's a killer. This is Rector Bailey.
Ha 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 ha
Have you heard about the new way of testing radio listeners? Fascinating. We found out that some programs relax people while others excite them. In order to find out which does which, they strap you down, turn on the radio full blast, and take your blood pressure. Let's see how this blood pressure test works. We have with us this evening the famous scientist, Professor Dr. Heinrich Javor Morgan, who will conduct the experiments. Right this way, Dr. Morgan.
Please. Yeah. Listen, I got to have a volunteer, please, in the audience. I got to have somebody so I could took his blood pressure.
Hey, how about me, Doc? Hey, how about me? Hey.
You? Yeah, all right, except I could use better somebody with blood, but we work it out some ways. Now sit down here. Now roll up the arm, please.
You mean roll up the sleeve, Doc?
All right, by you it's perfect English. Congratulations. Here, I roll it up for you. My goodness, what a skinny arm you got.
That's my chest, Doctor.
Well, never mind. We got to use something. All right. Turn on the radio, please, and tell me when a meter shows a change in his blood pressure.
All right, Doctor. Here's the first program. A mystery. Blood pressure up 10 points. Up 30.
Welcome to Inner Eardrum. Dark in here, isn't it?
Up 40.
This is the story of Oswald Krubisch, who was losing his mind. He had just killed his mother-in-law.
Blood pressure down to normal.
Krubisch watched his mind slowly slipping away.
I can't seem to remember anything. This headache. My mind. Where did I put it? I heard someone breathing.
Hello?
Clementine Phosphorus, you! What do you want?
It's no use, Krubisch. The police will be here any minute. They'll find you dead. It will look like suicide. Take your hand away from that buzzer.
Pressure up 30.
You can't. I'll do anything. I'll give you diamonds, money.
One more step and I'll shoot.
Pressure up 60. Sweat on forehead.
You wouldn't shoot. That gun is empty.
Down 30.
It isn't empty. It has 3 bullets in it.
Up 30.
I took all the bullets out.
Down 30.
I changed guns.
Up 30.
Your time has come, Krubisch.
Up 90.
Now, what is the patient's blood pressure, please?
He doesn't seem to have any, Doctor.
Interesting. Let me see. Don't have no pulse, neither. Also, he ain't breathing. Somebody remove the volunteer, please. Another volunteer, please. Now, we try other kinds program. We tie you up and you listen to a Mr. and Mrs. broadcast. We took you now to their little apartment, 6 o'clock in the morning. They talk about themselves and it's very interesting. Also, they got a baby. Tune in, please, Mr. and Mrs. Klabiash.
Good morning, Snugglepot.
Good morning, Bunny Fur.
How are you this lovely, cheerful morning, dearest Pie?
Fine, my bobolink. And how is Daddy's ever-loving lover?
Blood pressure down 10. Patient drowsy.
Oh, guess where I went yesterday, Chicky Wick.
Were you at the office?
Yes. That wasn't hard to guess, was it?
No, it wasn't, Snooky Poo.
Then why did you ask me to guess?
Well, I thought you asked me to guess.
Oh, I did?
Oh.
I thought you asked me, cuddle girl.
Maybe I did. Well, anyway, you guessed right, Peach Fuzz.
Blood pressure down 20. Patient requires plasma.
Oh, here's Nursey with the baby. Oh, isn't he cute?
Yeah. Whose is he?
Why, ours, Potato Puff. At least I think he is.
Oh, well.
Oh, he's trying to say something.
Gosh, and only 9 years old.
Blood pressure down 20. Hands clammy.
Oh, Pussy Willow. I meant to tell you, baby bit the milkman today.
Pressure sinking fast, Doctor. Doctor. Doctor, the experiment is over. Wake up!
Hey, Bud, come here. Step back in this dark doorway a minute, will you? I don't want nobody should interrupt our little conversation.
I picked you out of the crowd because you look like the type fella appreciates a good deal when he hears it. Listen, you heard about the Eversharp chicken injector razor? Eversharp. All the time sharp, it means. Chick injector. That means, well, that's the name of it. Razor means razor, like you shave yourself with. Listen, this here razor sells for $1.25 with 20 blades. It's quick, see, because it changes blades automatically. Wait a minute. Every time you buy an Eversharp Chick razor, it helps keep Morgan on the air. You heard the program? You think what? Is that so? Oh, is that so? Is that... How would you like a fat lip?
Well, now, go keep your hands off me. Cut it, David.
Not me, officer. I was just telling this guy about the Eversharp Chick injector. Well, look, all I said was $1.25. He tried... No, I was... He was... I got one on me. There you are. $1.25. All right, officer, thank you very much. Here's your change. Yeah, the blades are in there. Thanks. So long, officer. Now, wise guy, what were you saying about Morgan?
And now it's time to look in again on Charlie and Henry, two of the men who write the commercials that you hear on the air and the advertisements that you see in the magazines. Charlie is at the bar in his favorite saloon when in walks Henry.
Hello, Charlie.
Hello, Henry. Sit down and have a drink.
Oh, thanks. I'll have a shot of Red Eye Rye, the favorite among men who demand the fare. This blend of fine whiskeys is aged in barrels overnight and costs only a few cents more.
Well, I'll have the same. Henry, you look great.
Yes. I was tired, irritable, run down. Until I took Vita pills. Now I feel great. Never better in my life. Pick my weight in Wildcats, eat like a horse. Full of pep, vim, like a new man. I'm strong.
Henry, I'm sold.
Good. I was getting tired again.
Hey, I'll bet you're looking forward to your vacation this year.
Yes, indeedy. Last year, I took out a vacation savings policy. This splendid policy enables the man who sold it to me to take a 2 weeks vacation at my expense.
And what did you get out of it?
Travel booklets.
Well, I suppose you'll get in some golf. Have you played much lately?
Yes, indeedy. I've been using the Eversharp all-purpose golf club, which changes heads automatically. Just push, pull, click, click, and you're ready to slice.
Well, if you're going to be out in the sun, Henry, don't get burned.
No, sir. I use genuine Kickapoo suntan oil. I mix it with a little mustard and paprika and baste myself every half hour. Kickapoo suntan oil filters out the beta rays, allows in the gamma rays, keeps out the ionosphere, and lets in the low-frequency stuff.
Makes an even color?
No, blisters.
Well, your vacation has you smiling in anticipation. And, Henry, your smile is positively dazzling.
Of course. I brush my teeth with Dr. Banana's tooth powder. It has a secret ingredient which shrinks the lips, thereby exposing double the tooth surface.
Well, here's the waiter with our Red Eye Rye. Henry, you say it's really good?
Charlie, once you taste Red Eye Rye, you'll never ask for any other kind.
Why not?
It paralyzes the vocal cords.
Well, bottoms up. Down the...
What do you know? It really does.
As a public service and in the interests of international friendship, we bring you now the gossip column from the Russian newspaper Izvestia and the columnist Dimitri Morganovich Morgan. Here's his famous column, Dimitri's Keyhole.
Good evening, Mr. and Mrs. Russia, and all the...
So he ain't got no ships at sea.
Flash. as was exclusively predicted in this column last month. This month is February. Flash, I predict a new twosome. Vasily Vasilievich Kurtsukov was seen with Maria Nazimovna Tsakrenko lately. Remember their names. Flash, the moving pictures colony has discovered a new star. Blonde, petite, and only 18 years of old. This cutie pie is named Herzegovina Bielochuk. She hails from little old Vladivostok. Watch for her in new picture, The Road to Siberia. While we are on subject, what movie star who has wife is going around with movie star who has husband? You don't know. Ah, it may be your business. Say, next week opens here in Moscow unusual type nightclub. Imported direct from New York City, United States, America, 52nd Street. Anybody who is everybody is going there. Nowhere in Russia we got this. Little room, full of smoke, food no good, prices too high, floor show terrible, real American. Well, I got to go to opening, so this is Comrade Morganovich, Morgan's little boy Dimitri, saying goodnight to you, and I do mean, tovarich.
Strange stories of history.
When George Washington was a boy, on the occasion of his birthday, his father gave him a hatchet as a present. To see how the new hatchet worked, little George went out into the yard and cut down a cherry tree. Later, when his father asked him who had cut down the tree, little George replied, "I cannot tell a lie. The kid next door did it." This story has been cleaned up for kids. But Washington never realized that years later, Bernie Green and his orchestra would do this thing they're going to do now. Bernie has tossed in jazz, rumba, conga, something like the Benny Goodman Sextet, something of Lombardo and Count Basie, all based on music by Offenbach, whoever that is. Bernie calls it Offenbach on Broadway. And here is Uncle Charlie.
No other safety razor you ever used can compare with an Eversharp Chic injector. It's the only razor with an automatic blade changer. It gives you a shave so swift, so smooth, so easy, you hardly know you've got whiskers. Get your Eversharp Chic injector razor tomorrow. Discover for yourself the convenience of its automatic blade changer that changes blades when you need new blades like a machine gun. Fast as this, listen. Hear that double click? A push, a pull, click, click, and you're ready to shave. No blades to unwrap, no cut fingers. The blade automatically locks in the correct shaving position. Moreover, the patented guard bar holds each hair erect, so it's cut with maximum closeness. It makes clean, no-nick shaving under nose and lips easy. Eversharp Chic injector blades are double-thick, hollow ground, honed to superlative keenness. They last longer. For the cleanest, closest, smoothest shaves you've ever known, get an Eversharp Chic injector razor at your dealer's tomorrow. It's $1.75 value, the razor alone made to sell for $1, the blade 75 cents. Yet it's yours, complete, Eversharp Chic injector razor with 20 blades for only $1.25. Compare. Comparison proves. Use Eversharp Chic injector razor for the world's quickest, easiest, cleanest shave.
Hello.
Hello, Hortense. This is Gerard.
You have the operator.
I have?
Yes.
Well, I don't want her. What happened to Hortense?
To whom?
To my party.
Your party is temporarily out of order.
She is? Gee, what's the matter with my party?
Her dial is not working properly.
Oh. Well, how soon will my party be in order again?
We are not allowed to give out that information.
Even if I promise not to tell nobody?
I am sorry.
Gee, it sounds serious. Gee, this leaves me in a terrible mess.
I will give you repair service.
I don't need no repairs. My dial's working. Anyways, I just wanted to find out if she'd go to the Coming Attractions Theater with me.
I will give you information.
Hey, wait, operator.
Yes.
Maybe you like to step out with me tonight.
I will give you a slap in the face.
Gee, she didn't acquiesce.
Well, it's too bad that Hortense and Gerard won't be going to the Coming Attractions Theater tonight. There's a very good bill. Let's see, they're showing the coming attractions of The Yearling, The Dark Mirror. What? The Dark Mirror. Caesar and Cleopatra, The Killers, Lassie, Son of Lassie, Return of Lassie, Lassie Joins the Navy. The Razor's Edge, The Bride Wore White, and Selected Shorts. They're showing the best parts of $20 million worth of pictures for only 60 cents, their true value. The average American spends 120 hours a year at the movies, or enough time to recover from a serious illness. All this time can be saved at the Coming Attractions Theater. Professor, start the reel.
Coming, Mun, Choose, Wed, Sensation, Pitch.
Mightier than Mutiny on the Bounty.
More thrilling than 2 years before the mast.
A saga of desperate men on a whaling boat. Don't miss...
Blubber.
Blubber was produced by Repulsive Pictures. Makers of Repulsive Pictures.
Thrilling scenes as the whaling boat crosses the turbulent ocean with its precious cargo of blubber. You'll see the ruthless captain, Beast Morgan, ruling his crew with an iron hand.
Captain Morgan! Man overboard! Man overboard!
Is he an officer?
No!
Full speed ahead!
But Beast! That's the sucker man today who was washed overboard.
Tired, someone washed on this ship.
After all, Beast, you know we're not pimps. We're not swine. We're human beings.
Mr. Worcestershire, that's an exaggeration.
The Atlantic and Pacific Oceans used in this picture were borrowed from the United States Navy.
One beautiful girl on board, surrounded by 40 desperate, love-starved men. She's always enchanting, always exciting, always running.
Beast.
What is it, Sadie?
The men. They're threatening mutiny. They'll kill you.
Kill me? I'll slap your face for that.
Don't let them kill you, Beast. I love you.
Love me? I'll slap your face for that. What's your beautiful Sadie? Come here and let me...
I ought to slap your face for that.
You little she-devil. I feel like throwing you to the sharks.
Then why don't you?
Maybe I should have just slapped her face.
Well, that washes up, Sadie, and we've just saved you 20 minutes or enough time to write your congressman to keep rent control.
The picture, Blubber, is based on a help-wanted ad in the New York Times.
Beast Morgan was the terror of the seven seas and others. In scenes like these...
Mr. Worcestershire, come here.
Yes, Beast.
Orders for the day.
Yeah.
Every man gets 20 lashes for breakfast with milk. Hang the third mate from the yardarm. Give the ship pass. Haul down the skull and bones. Put up new ones.
Well, where am I going to get our new skull and bones?
Use the first mate.
You're a beast, Beast. But you're a great sailor.
Thank you, Mr. Worcestershire. Come here and I'll carve my initials on your chest.
Brute force meets brute force as violence sweeps the ship. The first time the ship has been swept.
Mr. Worcestershire, come here.
No.
Mr. Worcestershire, what does this mean?
The ship is ourn.
Yourn?
Yes, ourn.
Ourn!
These desperate sailors had wills of ourn.
Beast, we want that Blubber.
That's my Blubber.
Come on, Morgan. Where do you keep the Blubber?
I don't know. Am I my Blubber's keeper? Boo. What else do you men want?
This ship is in danger. The mice are deserting it.
You mean we're sinking?
No, they refuse to eat the food.
Mr. Springbottom, come here.
Yeah, please.
Mr. Springbottom, is this mutiny?
M-U-T-I-N. Yeah, it's mutiny.
You'll thrill at the sight of men fighting a storm at sea.
It's a north by nor'easter.
It's a sou'easter. It's Easter.
Shall we color eggs?
Captain! Captain, land ahead!
What?
Land ahead!
I can't hear you!
Land underneath!
You'll never see another picture like Blubber.
And that's a promise.
See this thrilling drama packed with chills, thrills, and... Blubber.
Mr. Henry Morgan, theater of current attraction.
Morgan will be on this same corner in front of the cigar store again next week at this same time.
Eversharp, manufacturers of Eversharp Chic injector razors and blades, invite you to tune in same time, same station next week when Eversharp will again bring you the Henry Morgan Show.
Not quite restored the way I like it, but you gotta admit it's funny stuff. 77 years ago, February 19, 1947, Henry Morgan here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Tomorrow, we will get back to crime and westerns with episodes of Frontier Town, Gunsmoke, The Shadow, Casey Crime Photographer, and Lum and Abner. Which one does Lum and Abner fit into? Now, up next, Bob Hope from 72 years ago, February 19th, 1952. That's next here on Classic Radio Theater.
In case of national civil defense emergency, the emergency broadcast system may be activated. Then you would receive essential information by turning your radio dial to an EBS station operating in your area. The emergency broadcast system stations will be easy to identify because of their repeated announcements of the area they're serving.
And now on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox, we go back 72 years, February 19th, 1952, for an episode of Bob Hope with his guest, Tyrone Power.
sound off, sound off, sound off for Chesterfield.
Good evening, folks, a big hello. We're here to start the Bob Hope Show. To get your kicks, enjoy the fun. Light up a Chesterfield, everyone.
Sound off
for Chesterfield.
Sound off
for Chesterfield.
Try a pack of Chesterfields. Do it!
Today!
Chesterfield presents the Bob Hope Show, transcribed direct from Hollywood, with Les Brown and his band of renown. For Chesterfield's yours truly, Hi Averback. Our special guests, Tyrone Power and Marilyn Maxwell. And here he is, Bob Hope.
Thank you very much. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Here I am back in Hollywood for Chesterfields, and it's good to be home. I've been doing so much traveling around the country that my kids don't recognize me anymore. This morning when I got home, I kissed my little girl Linda, and she said, "Mummy, here's another presidential candidate." But I got back in Hollywood just in time to see the unveiling of the new 1952 cars. I won't say the 52 cars are expensive, but the only way you can afford the new one is to use the old one for a getaway car. And the engineers are experimenting with an entirely new type of car. It's called a Harry Truman. No one knows if it'll run. And the weather has affected automobile design. I saw one model called the California Convertible. You press a button and it opens up into a canoe. Thank you, floaters. And some of the war orders must have gotten mixed up with the new cars. One guy ordered a Cadillac, and it arrived with a 16-inch gun mounted on the hood. Somewhere in the Pacific, there's an aircraft carrier with four white wall tires. But television is doing a great job selling cars. Why shouldn't it? It's done a great job selling radios. I was watching a silent movie the other night, and when the used car commercial came on, they were trying to sell the same car as the one in the picture. The television becoming a very powerful advertising medium. Yesterday afternoon, a jewelry store advertised a sale on diamond bracelets, and within 2 hours, it was held up. And new houses are going to have television in every room. In every room. Won't that be wonderful? If you don't like Crosby, you can throw a bath towel over him. But it can lead to a certain amount of confusion. One woman got so interested watching young Dr. Malone, she sterilized the can opener and took out the turkey's appendix. And another item that made news was the development of high-frequency television, which will make it possible to open new stations all over the country. They haven't got room to put the movies on the regular channels, so they may assign them to a high-frequency band. A high-frequency band is a series of oscillatory impulses causing a convolution of electrons to supercharge an ionic cyclotron impulsivating a nuclear centrifugal action on a predetermined pleiotropic isotope. There's more. Briefly, that means I fired that writer. They're also experimenting with telecasting new movies. I sat for 2 hours the other night and watched Quo Vadis on a 3-inch screen. It was an enjoyable experience. And besides, it's fun to have both your eyeballs looking out of the same socket.
Now, a voice well known to millions, Westbrook Van Voorhees.
In a recent decision, the Federal Trade Commission says of Brand X cigarettes that the use of diethylene glycol as a hygroscopic agent in the manufacture of X brand of cigarettes does not render such cigarettes non-irritating or less irritating than other leading brands of cigarettes using hygroscopic agents other than diethylene glycol.
If the Federal Trade decision has made you wonder about the contents of your cigarette, you can be glad if you're smoking Chesterfield.
Chesterfield gives you scientific facts and names its ingredients. Chesterfield uses tobaccos pre-tested by laboratory instruments for the most desirable smoking qualities and kept tasty and fresh by the only tried and tested hygroscopic agents proven by over 40 years of continuous use in USA tobacco products as entirely safe for use in the mouth. Pure natural sugars and chemically pure harmless glycerol. Nothing else. Chesterfield has the newest and most modern research laboratories and factories staffed by experts. Outside independent consultants include many eminent scientists from leading universities.
Chesterfield has, for your smoking pleasure and protection, every advantage known to modern science. Well, ladies and gentlemen, the workmen have finally finished remodeling Bob's home, and he's moved back in. Now, one of the first things he had to do was make a complete inventory for the insurance company. So let's go back to yesterday morning when Bob and I were hard at work making up the list. One reading lamp.
One reading lamp.
One end table.
One end table. Say, isn't this pretty guest room high? Gee, if these walls could talk, you have no idea how many celebrities have stayed overnight in this room.
One comb, one brush, a one-pint bottle of hair tonic.
Oh, yes, Mario Lanza likes to use that tonic on his hair.
One box of Vigoro.
That's what Crosby uses on his.
He won't give up.
One ashtray.
One ashtray.
One bowler hat.
Bowler hat? Yeah, Churchill was here the same time Crosby was.
Oh, well, why is the brim of his hat all chewed up?
Well, Churchill was a little nervous. Bing didn't want to approve the loan. Let's list those books on the shelf, High. Read the titles to me.
Okay, The Loves of Casanova.
Loves of Casanova.
Yoo-hoo, anybody home?
Well, sounds like Marilyn Maxwell. Yeah. Well, hello, Marilyn.
Hello, hello, fellas.
Say, go ahead, High.
Okay, Just We Two.
Just We Two.
From Here to Eternity.
From Here to Eternity.
Let's Build a Dream House of Love.
Where are you boys going on your honeymoon?
Marilyn, we're taking an inventory and we're listing the books and things. You can help if you want to. Start with that trophy case over there.
Okay. Gee, Bob, you've certainly got a lot of souvenirs and trophies here.
Hey, what's this baseball with 1949 written on it?
Well, I keep that to remind me of the date. That's the year my brother George got me to invest in the Cleveland Indians.
Oh, was it your brother George who got you to buy into the Cleveland Indians?
Yeah.
Gee, Bob, what a weird souvenir this is. Where did you get this shrunken head?
That's my brother George. Now we'll take inventory in my room, High. Be right back, Marilyn. We'll start with the wardrobe closet. One gray suit.
One gray suit.
Two dead moths.
Two dead moths.
One live moth. We got a new sound man, and he's so eager. Wait a minute. Where'd this suit come from, High? I don't have a powder blue gabardine.
Well, the cleaning man just delivered it, Bob.
Well, he made a mistake. This isn't my suit. It belongs to somebody else.
Well, look at the label. Oh, you're right, Bob. It says, tailored expressly for Tyrone Power.
Tyrone Power? Hey, that's a sharp sack, isn't it? I think I'll try it on. Maybe it'll make me look like him. I'll just slip off my trousers. There. Turn your back, please. There. Now I'll slip into these. Fasten the belt. Now the jacket. I'll just button this middle button. There. Hey, how about it, High? Well, High, say something.
It looked more like Tyrone Power when it was on the hanger.
But you're right. This suit doesn't belong to me. It was delivered here by mistake. It belongs to Tyrone Power. He must have my suit. I wonder if Ty'll notice the difference.
Oh, Parkins.
Yes, Mr. Power.
I have to get dressed, Parkins. What's holding things up?
Oh, the cleaning man brought you someone else's suit, sir. Look, this is the one he left here.
That's the suit he left?
Yes, sir. If I may say so, who would wear a thing like that?
Well, I don't know. Maybe there's a circus in town. Wait. I'll look at the label and see where this comes from. What a strange place to buy a suit.
What does it say, sir?
Civil War veterans rummage sale.
It's a very strange garment, sir. What material would you say it's made of? Unfinished worsted?
Oh, it looks more like reconditioned pup tent. There's no name on the label. Parkins, how can we find out who this suit belongs to?
Well, sir, let's reason it out the Sherlock Holmes way. Let's just ask ourselves who would be a big enough idiot to wear a silly jackass outfit like that.
Why, of course, Parkins.
Oh, yes, sir.
Why didn't we think of that before? What's Bob Hope's phone number? Or maybe I'd better take it over to Bob's house myself.
Oh, I'm afraid you'll have to wear it, sir. All your other clothes are still at the cleaner's.
I suppose I could sneak through the alleys. Help me into it. Well, these mix-ups sometimes happen, Bob.
Yeah, I'm glad we got it straightened out, Ty. I think I look pretty good in your suit. How do you like wearing mine? Did you notice I've got it fixed so when you pass a pretty girl, the buttons light up?
Yeah. I guess I shouldn't have gone by that Jane Russell billboard. The wiring blew a fuse and melted my garters.
I know what you mean. I met Dagmar on the street one day, and I blotted out all the television programs this side of Denver. Anyway, I like this suit of yours, Ty. Marilyn here tells me it looks very well on me.
Oh, it does, Bob. Why don't you get the name of Tyrone's tailor?
Oh, I've got a swell idea. Listen, Ty, if you'll get your tailor to make a suit for me, I'll get my tailor to make a suit for you. What do you say?
I don't like the odds.
By the way, how much do your suits cost?
Oh, they're fairly reasonable, Bob. My man makes them for $250 and up.
Well, that's pretty expensive. My tailor makes my suits for $47.50. The only reason he can make them that cheap is that I happen to use the same pattern as Cass Daly. But, Ty, Marilyn and I were about to rehearse our song for the radio show. Why don't you stick around?
Swell, Bob. I'd like to hear it.
Okay, let's go, Marilyn.
I was a clingin', swingin' vine. I wish I was a clingin', swingin' vine. If I was a clingin', swingin' vine, I'd cling right to that man of mine.
She wishes that she was a clingin' vine. Hi-ho, fiddly-dee, tell you what she'd like to be. Hi-ho, fiddly-dee, that's the dream she wants to be.
I wish I was Maureen O'Hara's cat. I wish I was Maureen O'Hara's cat. Then every time she stroked my fur, I'd just stand there and purr and purr.
We'd like to be Maureen O'Hara's cat. Hi-ho, fiddly-dee, tell you what he'd like to be. Hi-ho, fiddly-dee, that's the dreamy dream he wants to be.
Come on and join the party, Ty.
I wish I was a little orange tree. I wish I was a little orange tree. On freezing nights, how warm I'd be. They'd shove a smudge pot under me.
A little orange tree.
I wish I didn't look like Errol Flynn. Don't you think I look like Errol Flynn?
You may have Errol's manly chin, but your nose looked like the shrimp boat's in.
You look like Errol Flynn. Hi-ho, fiddly-dee, tell you what he'd like to be. Hi-ho, fiddly-dee, that's the dream he dreams he wants to be.
I'd like to be as popular as Bob.
Yeah, yeah.
But I'll never be as popular as Bob.
Well, you can't have power and everything.
Why, Bob's a man that girls forget.
I know, but he hasn't paid me yet.
Da-da-dee-da, da-dee-da-dee-da-dum. I wish I was a
moonbeam in the sky. I wish I was a moonbeam in the sky.
If I was a moonbeam in the sky, I'd spit right down in Crosby's eye.
I wish I was a moonbeam in the sky. I hope, fiddly-dee, tell you what I'd like to be. I hope, fiddly-dee, that's the dream I want to be. That's the dream I want to be.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, as a result of the mix-ups and suits, Tyrone Power stayed to dinner at Bob's house. We now find Bob and Ty in the living room having an after-dinner chat.
So you see, Bob, when I was lucky enough to bag a Bengal tiger, I was glad I joined the African Explorers Club. Do you happen to belong, Bob?
No, I don't, Ty, no.
But do you belong to the International Big Game Hunters?
Well, no, but I am a member of a very exciting club.
Oh, what club is that?
The Upper Glendale Crocheting and Yummy Yogurt Society. Very exciting, I swear.
Now, you're always kidding, Bob. But, you know, I'm glad I got this chance to talk to you alone. I've been wanting to ask you something for a long time.
Well, was it, Ty?
It's a little personal. You're sure you won't mind?
No, Ty, not at all. What is it?
Tell me, Bob, where did you learn the wonderful technique you have that gets all the beautiful women?
Me?
Yes.
Are you sure we both got the same script?
No, I'm serious, Bob. It's all over town. Wherever lovely women gather, you're the one they talk about. Now, don't tell me you didn't know.
Well, actually...
Oh, I guess I'm embarrassing you. I can see you're the type of man who doesn't like to brag about himself.
Yes, but force me.
Bob, I don't know why you're being so modest. You're the number one boy with the women. I hear your name is written in kisses on the wall of the powder room at Ciro's.
Yeah. How did you find out? That's what I wanted.
I heard.
Oh, I hear, yeah. Well, that's probably, Ty, that's probably that group of Ziegfeld Follies girls.
Well, then you'll agree, Bob, when it comes to women, you've got more on the ball than I have.
Well, if you insist.
Now, that's what I told the committee. I told them that you'd be much more capable of judging the beauty contest than I. You won't mind taking my place, will you?
Judging a beauty contest? Oh, I'd be glad to.
Swell, swell. A car will pick you up tomorrow afternoon, and I'm off the hook. Well, good night, Bob.
Oh, good night, Ty. Hey, by the way, do you know any of the gorgeous babes in the beauty contest?
What gorgeous babes? It's a contest to pick the shapeliest grandmother over 80. Good night, Bob.
How do you like that guy? All those compliments were just a sneaky way to get out of something he didn't want to do. Oh, Well, I'm tired. Think I'll stretch out on the sofa here and take a little nap. Him and his contest. I can tell him who the shapeliest grandmother is right now. But why should I give Arthur Godfrey free publicity? Ooh, I'm tired. That Tyrone Power is just jealous because I look better in his suit than he does. What does he know about style? On my suit, he couldn't even find the place where you blow up the shoulders. If I'd spent as much time in Europe as he has, I could be a continental lover just like Tyrone.
Wake up, Mr. Power. Your breakfast is ready.
Mr. Power? Oh, am I Tyrone Power?
Why, of course you are, sir. Are you sure you didn't have too many pink champagnes at the Countess's reception last night?
Oh, yes, yes, it all comes back to me now. I am Tyrone Power, the greatest continental lover in Europe. What's for breakfast, Parkins?
Caviar, truffles, poached swan eggs, Benedict, Chinese pheasant holding a strawberry in its beak, and frog legs sandpapered smooth and served on tiptoe.
Gad, every day the same thing. And Parkins, what's wrong with this coffee? It doesn't taste right.
Oh, I'm sorry, sir. I had to make it with water. We were all out of champagne.
How can you be such a peasant? I sometimes despair that you... Oh, come in.
Ah,
There you are, Tyrone. Kiss me, my darling. Oh, I love you. I love you.
I love you too, my sweet.
Just the thought of you starts a flame burning inside of me.
Yes, darling, you're all I live for. Kiss me.
Farewell, until later.
Who was that, sir?
I was hoping you knew. Any mail, Parkins?
Tons of it, sir, from your admirers.
Well, I keep searching because I know someday I'll find my dream girl. She must have the dainty feet of Pierre Angela, the legs of Marlena Dietrich, the eyes of Jean Tierney, and the lips of Hedy Lamarr.
What progress have you made, sir?
Well, so far, I've got the shoes of Marjorie Maine. But let's get to the mail. Ah, here's an interesting envelope written in lavender ink. Well, let's see what it says. I can't go on without you. Meet me tonight at the Continental Cafe. I'll be the blonde wearing the white gown with green sequins in my hair.
Is it signed Anxious?
No, but it's signed Taft, and that's the same thing. Ah, the intrigue of a new romance. Lay out my best evening suit, Parkins. The powder blue gabardine. Tonight, I live. Ah, there you are, my mystery girl.
So, sweetheart, we have found each other.
Yes. Yes, it was easy. You're the only one here with green sequins in her hair. How did you find me?
Oh, you are the only one here with red sequins in your hair.
I have to wear those red sequins. I don't have a taillight on my bicycle. You're ravishing, my dear. What is your name?
Oh, I have so many names. I am the Countess Maria Fuscelli, Angelina Sheila, Moritz, Rita, Gloriana, Consuela, Florential, Marlene de Moore. Which one do you like the best?
I don't know. It all looks so good.
You know, Tyrone, I am very rich. Make me your favorite and I'll build you a mansion.
Oh, no thanks.
I'll give you expensive racing cars. Shower you with precious jewels.
Oh, no thanks.
But it must be something you want.
Well, I could use a taillight for my bicycle. Shall we dance?
Oh, I would love to, but look, the floor show is about to commence.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Café Continental has a wonderful surprise for you. For the first time on the Riviera, we present the famous American comedian, Bob Hope.
Oh, thanks for the memory. Oh, thank you very much. Thank you all so much. Thank you all so much, so much, so much, so much, so much. I thank you so much.
I don't like the tune, but it's got swell words.
Quietly, tell me, he's very funny.
How do you do, everybody? This is Bob, by and by the carton Hope, saying, pardon me if I strut, I can't keep my mouth shut, because about Chesterfield, I'm really nuts. I smoke them down as far as I can, and then wash and iron the butts. Yeah, 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 yeah.
First time I ever laid an egg with someone else's lair.
If you think that's funny, listen to this one. I was walking down the street, and a tramp came up to me. He said, Mister, I haven't had a bite for 2 days. So I bit him. As the farmer said to the cow, I'm really pulling him.
If I sound like that, I'll throw myself off the highest cliff on Sydney Green Street.
Well, that's the end of my routine, folks. As the baby bear said when it sat down on the cake of ice, my tale is told.
What material? Milton Berle wouldn't touch that stuff with a 10-foot airwick.
Oh, I think this Bob Hoops is cute, and I'm going to dance with him.
Hey, come back here.
Oh, Mr. Hoops, you're so interesting, and you dance very well, too. Will you dance with me again?
Sure I will, babe, as long as you keep putting quarters in the meter.
Pardon me, Countess. Could I have the honor of cutting in?
Why, of course, Tyrone.
Well, here we go.
Oh, Tyrone, you're the best dancer I've ever danced with. You're so wonderful at the waltz, the rumba, the samba, and the tango. Oh, what a dancer.
Thank you.
Say, by the way, what are those things sticking out of your sleeves?
Arthur Murray's hands. He's in the suit with me. Ah, Countess, you're lovely tonight.
Okay, I'm cutting in. Bobsy boy is back.
Out of the way, peasant, or I'll run you through with my sword. And everyone knows that I, Tyrone, am the greatest swordsman in Europe. On guard.
But I ain't got a sword.
I have a weapon in my purse. Here, take this ruby-handled dagger.
Okay. Ha-ha! Touché!
Oh! Oh! He got me!
Oh, Tyrone, can I ease the pain? Turn over and I pull the dagger out of your back.
No, leave it there. I want the ruby handle sticking out of my back.
But why?
This way I won't have to buy a taillight for my bicycle.
All thanks for the memory of the UN's fight for peace. We know they'll never cease till they guarantee a world that's free and sign a long-term lease. And we thank them so much.
That about wraps it up for tonight. Want to thank Tyrone Power for a fine performance.
Love the way he did those monologue jokes. I should have let him handle the first monologue, don't you think? Huh?
Also thank Marilyn Maxwell. Fine show. And remember, folks, to sound off for Chesterfield and do it today. For the first time, you'll get the cigarette that's much milder with the added protection of no unpleasant aftertaste.
Remember, that added protection, no unpleasant aftertaste, is confirmed by a leading research organization. Next week, Chesterfield presents the annual Look Achievement Award winners in a special Bob Hope Show with Danny Thomas, Vivian Lee, Mitzi Gaynor, Sam Goldwyn, George Stevens, Arthur Freed, Eddie Mayhoff, Bob O'Donnell, and others. That's next Tuesday at the same time on the Bob Hope Show. Tonight's appearance of Tyrone Power was made possible through 20th Century Fox Studios, whose current release is Phone Call from a Stranger, starring Shelley Winters, Gary Merrill, and Betty Davis. Be sure to listen to the Bob Hope Show next week, featuring the annual Look Achievement Award winners. The Bob Hope Show was written by Norman Sullivan, Marvin Fisher, and Larry Klein, and transcribed in Hollywood.
Years ago, February 19th, 1952, The Bob Hope Show here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Tomorrow we will have Frontier Town, Gunsmoke, The Shadow, Casey Crime Photographer, and Lum and Abner. That's all coming up. And visit our webpage, classicradio.stream, to support the program. You can find all sorts of great things there. You can learn about building a classic radio collection of your own. You can find our social media links, and you can also buy something nice there or buy me a coffee. That's at classicradio.stream. Up next, from 74 years ago, Jack Benny.
Not long ago, a jet bomber was considered fast if it could fly 500 miles an hour. Today, an intercontinental ballistic missile travels at a speed of 15,000 miles an hour. It can speed one-third of the way around the world in less than half an hour. If our nation should ever be attacked, every minute would be vital. In the event of attack, Designated radio stations in the emergency broadcast system will continue on their regular frequencies and will immediately begin bringing you official federal, state, and local government information and civil defense instructions. All other radio and television stations will go off the air. So when the emergency broadcast system is activated, just tune around on your standard band radio dial until you find the station that identifies itself as serving your vicinity. Then follow the instructions you hear.
And these instructions tell you to hang around because we're going to hear an episode of the Jack Benny Show, one that we could never air because the cigarette references throughout the entire show were too much to edit out, so we couldn't air it on broadcast radio. Back in the day, that was fine. But this is from 74 years ago, February 19th, 1950, Jack Benny.
The Jack Benny Program, presented by Lucky Strike. Let your own taste and throat be the judge. For smoothness and mildness, there's never a rough puff in a Lucky Strike. For smoothness and mildness, there's never a rough puff in a Lucky Strike. Yes, let your own taste and throat be the judge. For smoothness and mildness, there's never a rough puff in a Lucky Strike. And that's because LSMFT... LSMFT. Lucky Strike means fine tobacco. Fine, light, naturally mild tobacco that gives you smoothness and mildness. And no wonder, for years, Lucky Strike has maintained America's largest and most complete cigarette research laboratory. Prior to the auctions, the buyers for Lucky Strike send sample leaves from all tobacco growing areas to this great laboratory for scientific analysis, to help determine which tobaccos are really fine. And this is only one phase of the constant research that helps make possible Lucky Strike's unconditional guarantee. Check the cigarette you're now smoking. Among all leading brands, only the makers of Lucky Strike put an unconditional guarantee on the pack. So smoke a Lucky. Let your own taste and throat be the judge. For smoothness and mildness, there's never a rough puff in a Lucky Strike. So round, so firm, so fully packed, so free and easy on the draw. Make your next carton Lucky Strike.
The Lucky Strike Program, starring Jack Benny, with Barry Livingston, Phil Harris, Rochester, Dennis Day, and yours truly, Don Wilson. Ladies and gentlemen, for the past 2 weeks, Jack Benny and his troupe have been in New York. So now let's pick them up on the Super Chief en route to Los Angeles. Mary and Jack are playing a game of Gin Rummy.
You sure are lucky, Mary. I play better gin than you do, and yet you always win.
Well, it's your own fault, Jack. You don't concentrate on the cards.
I do, too. Now, let's see. I know you have three nines, three queens, and the six, seven, and eight of hearts. So I know you can't use this card. Here's the deuce of spades.
Gin.
Gin? Let me see your hand.
There you are. Three eights, four kings, and three deuces.
Wait a minute. Where are those two nines you picked up?
That was yesterday.
No. Well, go ahead and deal the cards again. Yeah, I never played in such bad luck in all my life.
Hey, Jackson, you got a corkscrew?
Here you are, Phil.
Thanks.
See, I hope I have better luck with this hand than I...
Pick up your cards.
Okay. I hope I...
Jack, pick up your last card.
Whoops. Oh, boy. What a hand this is. Mary, I'm warning you. Any card you throw, I can use. Go ahead, throw one.
It's your turn first.
Oh, yeah. Here.
Gin. Jack, it wasn't my fault. Stop pulling my hair.
Oh, I'm sorry, Mary. I didn't mean to get so excited. Well, that's enough gin rummy for me. What do I owe you?
$5.20.
All right, I'll pay you tomorrow.
Oh, Jack, you always say that. Why don't you pay up as soon as you lose?
Because it's so inconvenient.
I don't care. Take off your shoe and pay me.
All right, I'll pay you. I'll pay you. Turn around.
Turn around? Just because you're going to take your shoe off?
The fives are pinned to my underwear. Here's your money.
Thanks.
You're welcome. You know, Mary, you're the luckiest
person. Hey, Jackson, you got a bottle opener?
Here you are, Phil.
Thanks.
As I was saying, Mary, you're the luckiest person I've ever seen.
Oh, I'm not lucky. You just don't know how to play gin rummy.
Oh, I don't, eh? Well, I'll tell you what. You won $5 for me. I'll play you one more hand, double or nothing.
All right.
And we'll use this other deck. Now, shuffle them and shuffle them good.
Okay.
Show you.
If they're shuffled enough, Mr. Benny, I'll deal.
Wait till I cut them, sister. There. Go ahead and deal.
Just a minute.
You don't have to roll up your sleeves. I trust you. Go ahead and deal. This time, Mary, I'll show you that you can't be lucky all the time. There's a law of averages, you know.
Okay, pick up your cards.
I got them. Well, this is more like it. Now, let's see. This card I don't need. Here.
I don't want that one. I'll pick. Here, I'll give you this one.
Oh, boy, right in the middle. I go down with 6.
Well, you caught me this time. I'm stuck with 24 points.
Good, good. Where's the pencil?
Put your cards down first.
There. Now, let's see. 6 from 24. That gives me...
Oh, wait a minute. I can put the 7 and 8 on your heart run.
Where? Oh, yes.
Ah, but that still leaves me with 9.
You're darn right. 6 from 9 gives me...
Oh, wait a minute. I can play my deuce on your 3 deuces.
Where?
Right there.
Oh, yeah, but you're still stuck with 7, and 6 from 7 gives me...
Hello, kids.
Oh, hey, Don, I just clipped Mary.
Oh, stop bragging. I only got stuck with this 7 of clubs.
7 of clubs? Well, Mary, why don't you put it on his 4, 5, 6?
Oh, yes.
What?
That leaves me with nothing. You lose.
Don.
Yes, Jack?
Every year you're voted as radio's best announcer, aren't you?
Well, yes, Jack.
Well, it shouldn't be hard for you to get another job. Now get out of here.
Oh, don't be such a sore loser.
He's right. What time do we get to Los Angeles, Don?
8:45 tomorrow morning.
Gosh, another night on the train.
Hey, Jackson, you got any extra glasses in there?
Yes, there are 3 of them over there.
Thanks.
Say, Jack, I'm a little hungry. How about sandwiches?
All right, Mary, I'll go to the diner and get some. I'll be back in a few minutes.
Okay.
Let's see, the diner's down this way. Gee, imagine them charging 95 cents for a sandwich. Do you hear that whistle down the line? I reckon that it's engine number 99. All those prices that you have to pay on the Atchison, Topeka, and the sand. Let's see, the diner must
be... I beg your pardon, mister.
Yeah?
Could you tell me which way the engine is?
The engine? Oh, yes, you're going in the wrong direction. It's the other way. Why do you want to know?
I'm the engineer.
I don't mind. The engineer? Hey! Yeah, I hope he finds it before we reach Los Angeles. It'll be the first time I ever went to Catalina by rail. Now, let's see. The diner should be in this next car.
Well, from what you told me, Rochester, I don't see how Mr. Bennett got along without you.
Uh-oh. There's Rochester in the washroom talking to one of the porters. I gotta listen to this.
Anything else you want to know, Roy?
Yeah, besides writing Mr. Bennett's radio show, what else you do for him?
Well, I'm his publicity agent, manager, and last but not least, his personal advisor.
Oh, well, are you going to let Mr. Bennett go on television?
Well, we'll be happy to discuss any other offers.
Oh, why did you say that so loud?
I want people to hear. We ain't had any yet. Yes, sir, Mr. Benny won't do a thing without my approval.
Rochester, another thing I've been wanting to ask you. How old is Mr. Benny?
39?
Well, I thought that was just a joke on the radio.
Well, in the vernacular, we people in show business, that is known as a running gag.
Well, how long has it been running?
2 years longer than the Atchison, Topeka, and Santa Fe.
Rochester!
Uh-oh!
Is that Mr. Benny?
It ain't your host!
Rochester, I don't like you discussing my private affairs.
Yes, sir.
And will you please go to the diner and get some ham sandwiches for me and Miss Livingston?
Boss, would you mind making that cheese?
Why?
I just told Roy I was your personal advisor.
All right. Just get the sandwiches.
Yes.
And take that sign off your back. I'm not considering television till next year. I think he'd know better than to talk about me in front of strangers. Let's see. Oh, here's Mary's compartment.
Gee, it took you a long time. Where are the sandwiches?
I sent Rochester. Oh, hello, Dennis.
Hello, Mr. Benny.
Hey, kid, I haven't seen you all day. What have you been doing?
Oh, I was in the club car looking out the window, counting the telephone poles. I wanted to see if my mother was right.
What?
Well, she says there are 119,726 poles between Kansas City and Albuquerque.
Well, how would your mother know?
She dug the holes for them.
Why do I ask him? Why do I ask him?
Say, Jack, would you like to play a little more gin rummy till the sandwiches get here?
Well, all right, Mary. Move over, Don. Keep your mouth shut.
Okay. Oh, by the way, Jack, I haven't seen your riders since we left New York. Are they on this train?
No, they took another one.
Well, why don't you have them come with us? Are you ashamed of them?
Ashamed of them? Of course not. My four riders are very famous. Three of them have their pictures in the Brown Derby, and the other has his in the post office.
Oh, yes. Dead or alive, Sam.
Yeah. Mendel's got a private room. Say, this is a pretty good hand you dealt me.
Hey, Mr. Benny, why don't you put those two kings together?
Be quiet. You're giving my whole hand away. And anyway, they're queens.
Gee, if she just throw you the seven of spades, you could go right down.
Dennis! Let's see. I'll give you this one, Mary. The eight of hearts.
I'll take it. And here's the three of diamonds.
I don't need it. I'll pick. Oh, that's a beaut. Now, let's see. What'll I give you?
Give her the end card.
No. I'll give her this one. Here.
I'll take it.
Hmm.
Here, Jack, I'll give you this one.
I don't need it. I'll pick. Now, let's see.
Give her the end card.
No, you saw what she picked. I'll give her this one.
Oh, no, not that card. Give her the end card.
Well, maybe you're right. She did pick up those other two. Here, Mary.
Gin.
Dennis.
I guess I've only got one show now.
Look, kid, why don't you go back to the club car and count telephone poles?
No, I gotta practice my song for Sunday's broadcast, so I'll see you later.
What song are you gonna do this Sunday, Dennis?
The Dream is a Wish Your Heart Makes from Walt Disney's new picture, Cinderella. Would you like to hear it?
Yes, yeah, sing it. Do anything. Just leave me play. Okay. Deal, Mary.
You keep on believing.
Dennis, that was wonderful.
Thank you, Mary.
It was great, kid, but when you do it on the show... Now, listen, Dennis, sing it a little faster because we're kind of tight for time.
Okay.
Now, go ahead, Mary. It's your draw.
Hey, Jackson.
What?
You got a couple of aspirins.
So you finally got yourself a little headache, eh? Well, don't expect any sympathy from me, Phil.
Gin.
No, thanks, Mary. I've had all I...
Phil! Gin sometimes can mean something else. Mary, look, this hand doesn't count because I wasn't watching. Now deal the cards again.
Come in.
Telegram for Mr. Harris.
Oh, I'll take it, Porter. Here, this is for you.
Mmm, a dollar. Thank you, Mr. Harris.
Well, go ahead and read it, Phil. What does it say in the dollar? In the telegram? Go ahead, Phil, read it.
Let's see. Oh, no.
Well, who's it from, Phil?
The boys in my band.
What does it say?
Hurry home, we're in again. Well, look, I better send him a wire, tell him when I'm going to arrive. See you later, huh?
Well, come on, Jack. Let's finish our game of gin.
No, Mary. I'm going out to look for Rochester and see what's taking him so long with the sandwiches.
Okay, and hurry back. I'm starved.
Okay, Mary. Yada-dee-bum-bum-bum-bum-bum-bum-ba-da-dee-da-dee-da-dee-da-dum. Gee, this trip has been exciting. Saw the Mississippi, the Grand Canyon, the dollar tip. Oh, well. Oh, there's that cute little baby. Do you mind if I hold him, madam?
No, not at all.
Hello, baby. Ah, look at him. He's so cute. And his eyes are the same color as mine. Lake Louise blue. Yeah. How old is he, lady?
39.
What?
Weeks.
Oh. You know, lady, yesterday when you were in the diner, I came through here and I played with him. Didn't I, baby?
Uh-huh. Gin!
Well, he's luckier than Mary. Here, take him back, lady. You have a lovely child.
Thank you.
You'll find $5 he won pinned to his diaper. Hey, what a little doll that baby is. Cutest thing ever.
Excuse me. Oh, it's you, Jack. I was just going up to the diner.
Oh. Well, Don, I sent Rochester up there for some sandwiches. If you see him, hurry him up, will you?
All right, I will.
Oh, Don, before you go, there's something I got to tell you. The most amazing thing happened a little while ago.
What is it, Jack? What happened?
Well, I was in Mary's compartment with Phil when the porter brought him a telegram.
Yes?
And Phil gave him a dollar tip.
Well, what about it?
What about it? Donnie gave him a dollar tip. A dollar just for bringing him a telegram. He didn't press his suit or anything.
Well, Jack, there's nothing unusual about that.
You mean that you...
Certainly, all the time.
Gosh.
Jack, in these times when you're in a hotel or on a train and people do a personal service for you, it's customary to give them a dollar tip.
It is?
Yes, and you might as well get used to it.
I will not. All right, Don, you go on to the diner. I'll see you later.
Oh, wait a minute, Jack. I just remembered something. I've got a surprise for you.
A surprise?
Yes, step right over here to compartment H.
Gee, I wonder what the... Right here?
Yeah, open the door.
Oh, for heaven's sake. Well, the Sportsman Quartet. Hello, fellas. what are they doing on the train?
Oh, they got on at Albuquerque. They've been there all week on a personal appearance.
Well, Don, I'm glad the boys are with us and that they'll be on the show Sunday. Are they happy that they're going home? You know, back to Los Angeles?
Ooh, are they? Listen to this, Jack.
We love those dear hearts and gentle people who live in our hometown. Though it may shower most any hour, they'll never, ever let you drown. They read Luella from Friday to Monday, in fact, the whole week through. We may have fog, smog, or sun on Sunday, it makes no difference, no one's blue. We feel so welcome at Hollywood and Vine.
Love to eat inside that derby they call brown.
La Brea Tar Pits, the farmer's market, they're all a part of our hometown. There is something in the air that you can't find anywhere. When the smudge pots smudge, you never feel the heat. There's a Chinese picture show that's at Grumman Runs, you know, where they have cement for stars to put their feet. We love those dear, we love those dear hearts and lucky people who smoke in our hometown.
They smoke those lucky,
they smoke those luckies, because a lucky will never ever let you down. They are so free and so easy on the draw.
Take a tip from one who knows and you will see.
There ain't a rough puff, it's fine tobacco, so light an LSMFT. It's always LSMFT. Yes, LSMFT.
Fellas, that was great. It'll be wonderful on the show. Well, Don, I think I'll go back and play a little more gin with Mary and then have the berth made up and go to sleep.
I'm going to turn in early, too.
Okay, Don, see you later. I'll soon be back home in California, and I'll pay my income tax when I get there. And if I have to, I'll play my fiddle in the middle of old Pershing Square. Well, about another hour of gin, and I'll go to bed.
Oh, boy, this berth feels good. It's nice to be able to stretch out.
Yeah, but stop stretching over to my side, will you, Jack?
I'm sorry, Don.
I don't know why you insist on traveling like this. These berths are only built for one.
Don, you know as well as I do, it's hard to get accommodations on the Super Chief. We're lucky we're in here.
I suppose so. Anyway, I'm too cramped to argue.
All right, then drop it.
You don't have to get huffy about it, you know.
Look, I'm not getting huffy.
Hey, fellas, be quiet. How do you expect me to sleep here between you two?
I'm sorry, Dennis. Good night, Don.
There he goes, Don. Every night it's the same thing, snoring and mumbling.
Ah, don't worry, kid. We'll be home tomorrow.
I'd like to punch him right in the nose. Shut up! I can't go to sleep.
Well, Dennis, why don't you try counting sheep?
Counting sheep?
Yeah.
Well, okay. One, two, three, four, five, six. No, that's a sheepdog. Seven, eight, nine, ten.
Gin.
Thank you.
Los Angeles! Los Angeles Union Station! Your luggage will be taken to the cab stand.
Ah, well, Mary, here we are, home at last.
Can I brush you off, Miss Livingston?
Yes, please. Well, thank you.
Can I brush you off, Mr. Day?
Yes, please. Thank you.
Brush you off, Mr. Wilson?
Please.
Now, Don, if you'll turn around, he can brush your back.
Never mind.
Brush you off, Mr. Benny?
Yes, please. Thank you, Porter. Here.
I'm sorry. I don't have change for that dollar, Mr. Benny.
I don't want change. Keep it. This dollar is for you. Come on, Mary. I love those dear hearts and gentle people.
Gee, it's good to be home, isn't it, Jack?
Yeah. Let's go over here to the cab stand.
Extra, extra. Get your paper here. Extra. Read all about it. Jack Benny tips Porter a dollar.
Gee, I knew it would be in the papers, but how did they get it so soon? Come on, Mary. Everybody's staring at me.
Train leading on track 5 for Anaheim, Azusa, and Cucamonga.
Oh, boy. Even he sounds good. Ladies and gentlemen, the American Heart Association has set a goal of $6 million to be used for research, for education, and for community service. Heart disease is our greatest challenge because it takes more lives than any other illness and causes tremendous disability.
Yes, ladies and gentlemen, won't you please help support the 1950 Heart Campaign? Send your contributions to Jack Benny, Box 500, New York City. Jack will be back in just a moment, but first...
Let your own taste and throat be the judge for smoothness and mildness. There's never a rough puff in a Lucky Strike, and that's because... L-S-M-F-T, L-S-M-F-T. Lucky Strike means fine tobacco. Fine, light, naturally mild tobacco. Listen to what Mr. J. Coy Smith, an independent tobacco warehouseman from Greenville, North Carolina, recently said.
I'm in my 37th year as a warehouseman, and down through the years, I've seen the makers of Lucky Strike buy fine tobacco. Light, ripe tobacco that makes mild, smooth smoking. I've smoked Lucky's for 31 years.
Millions of smokers, including the famous dancing star of stage and screen, Ray Bolger, take a tip from the experts and smoke Lucky Strike. Just recently, Mr. Bolger said,
cigarettes like dancing must be smooth to be really enjoyable. Naturally, I go for Lucky's fine tobacco.
And for your own real deep-down smoking enjoyment, light up a Lucky. Let your own taste and throat be the judge. For smoothness and mildness, there's never a rough puff in a Lucky Strike. Get a carton today.
Well, Rochester, here we are at home. The house looks good, doesn't it?
Sure does, boss.
I'm going upstairs, take a shower, a shave, and get cleaned up.
Okay, boss, and while you're doing that, I'll unpack your bags.
No, no, Rochester, don't touch those bags.
Why not?
As soon as I get cleaned up, I gotta rush back to the railroad station.
For what?
I gotta catch a train. I'm going back to Washington for the White House Photographer's Ball.
But, boss, that don't make sense. If you're going right back to Washington, why'd you come all the way home from New York?
I told you to take a shower. There's a water shortage there. Have a cab here in 15 minutes. Good night, Claudette. Come on.
To send your contributions to the 1950 Heart Campaign to Jack Benny, Box 500, New York City. And be sure to hear Dennis Day in A Day in the Life of Dennis Day. Stay tuned for the Amos and Andy Show, which follows immediately. This is CBS, the Columbia Broadcasting System.
The Funny he should mention A Day in the Life of Dennis Day. By the way, that was the Jack Benny Show from 74 years ago, February 19th, 1950, here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Funny he should mention it, because we're going to go to February 19th, 1949, and hear A Day in the Life of Dennis Day. That's up next.
Civil defense is common sense. This is Howard Duff with this reminder. 640 and 1240. These are the Conrad frequencies during a national emergency. 640 and 1240 on your regular radio will be your only official means of receiving vital information. Remember, 640 and 1240.
Thanks for tuning in to Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. As promised, we go back to February 19th, 1949, an episode of The Day in the Life of Dennis Day.
Ladies and gentlemen, Dennis Day.
Every song I sing, I'll sing to you, and I hope I can bring you a smile or two.
Dennis Day is brought to you by Palmolive Soap and Palmolive Shave Creams. Palmolive Soap, your beauty hope, and Palmolive Shave Creams for a smoother, more comfortable way to shave. And now, here is Dennis.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Tonight, the Alumni Society of my alma mater, Manhattan College, is holding its annual dinner in the Grand Ballroom of the Roosevelt Hotel in New York. Since I can't be there in person, I would like to be there in voice and spirit by singing for the student body and alumni of Manhattan one of our college songs, Manhattan Men.
Manhattan Men, see your alma mater beckoning. Look once again to the day of joyous reckoning. Battle brings her further to the fore. Let us lend a helping hand. Onward, onward, Manhattan men. We must never stop until the banner of our college waves at the very top. Time will make our conquest complete, something for all the world to see. So green and white, we'll fight with all our might for this victory. Onward, onward, Manhattan men, we must never stop until the banner of our college waves at the very top. Time will make our conquest complete, something for all the world to see. So green and white, we'll fight with all our might for this victory.
Men, do you shave with a lather or brushless shave cream? Palmolive Shave Cream comes both ways, and whichever method you use, you'll find the new Palmolive Shave Cream way to shave means more comfortable, actually smoother shaves for three men out of every four. Yes, three men out of every four get more comfortable, actually smoother shaves the Palmolive Shave Cream way. It's a fact, men, not a promise. 2,548 men tried the new Palmolive way to shave, and no matter how they shaved before, 79% found beards cut easier, 75% less razor pull, 69% closer shaves, 80% smoother feeling skin. And three out of every four got more comfortable, actually smoother shaves. Just get Palmolive Shave Cream, either brushless or lather, and do this. Wash your face with soap and water. Rinse, then soap face thoroughly again. Do not rinse. Work Palmolive Shave Cream upward into beard to get the full benefit of Palmolive Shave Cream's beard conditioning effect. Then shave. That's all. But remember, Palmolive Shave Cream, either brushless or lather, offers proof of more comfortable, actually smoother shaves for three men out of every four.
few of us achieve the prominence of a mention in the public press. Our young hero, Dennis Day, made it once when he became the only man in the history of Weaverville Public School to enter the eighth grade under the GI Bill of Rights. But real fame has always eluded him, until today. He's just burst open the front door of the Anderson house in a state of wild excitement to come face to face with his astonished girlfriend, Mildred.
Mildred, the evening paper, is it here? My picture's in it, Mildred, my picture.
Your picture?
Yeah, for the Weaverville safety campaign, to cut down street accidents. You see, some people cross streets outside of the safety zone, some cross against the lights, some cross diagonally from corner to corner.
But why did they take your picture?
I was the first person to do everything wrong at the same time.
So that's it.
Sure, I'm famous. I've been chosen the pedestrian most likely to decease. Isn't it wonderful?
Well, yes, I guess so. How long has this safety campaign been going on?
Oh, it started this morning. The mayor began it himself with speeches at the corner of 3rd and Elman from the hospital.
Gee. Two speeches in one morning?
Well, it was really one speech continued. While he was speaking at the corner of 3rd and Elm, a car hit him.
Well, the paper's right here. Let's see now.
Oh, look, right there on page one. Read that caption.
Do you wish to visit a cemetery permanently? All you have to do is walk across the street in the criminally careless manner of Dennis Day, 22, whose photo appears above.
That's me.
At first, Mr. Day was believed drunk or crazy, but it was later learned he walks this way all the time.
I'm going to send clippings to all my friends.
Well, they've certainly given you quite... Why, Dennis.
What?
Well, the picture, it isn't your picture at all.
Oh, Mildred, you must be mistaken.
I'm not. Look, your hair's black, this man's a blonde. You're clean-shaven, he has a mustache. You have a small nose and he has a great big one. And you're wearing a blue suit, he has on a gray one with a Dewey button in the lapel. Don't you see?
Gee, you're right, it can't be me. I'm a Democrat.
It isn't you. They ran a picture of another man over your story.
Well, that's a fine thing. I nearly get myself killed and they give someone else credit for it.
Yes, I know how you feel. Well, you were almost famous, Dennis.
Yeah, darn it anyway. I was going to use that picture to start a couple of scrapbooks for our children.
Gee, do you really think we'll have some someday, Dennis?
Why not? I saw some swell ones for sale at Woolworth's the other day. Well, I'll see you at dinner.
Dinner will be ready as soon as Dennis comes down, Herbert.
Very well, my feta baron.
Anything new in the paper tonight?
Well, I see some fella stuffed his wife into a trunk and threw it in the lake.
Oh, my, isn't that awful?
Yeah, it'll probably spoil the fishing for months. Why, great Scott.
What's the matter?
Why, right here on page 18, there's a picture of Dennis Day.
Dennis Day? What's his picture doing in the paper?
Listen to what it says under it. Still missing after 4 years' search, Schuyler Van Rensselaer, heir to the great Van Rensselaer sardine fortune, pictured above is believed amnesia victim.
You mean... Oh, Herbert, it can't be Dennis Day.
Well, it must be. It's his picture.
Amnesia. So that's it. I knew no one could act like Dennis does and be normal. Oh, that poor, unfortunate, dear, sweet, rich boy.
Guy, so it isn't our Dennis Day at all. He's Schuyler Van Rensselaer, who was in the fish business.
I knew there was something about that boy.
Really? Well, I've stood very close to him and I never noticed it.
Read the rest of it, Herbert.
It just says that young Van Rensselaer was born November 17th, 1927. His brother and sister are offering $10,000 reward to anyone successfully aiding him in the recovery of his memory.
$10,000? Herbert, We've got to bring back that boy's memory. My maternal instincts have been aroused.
Yeah, I know how you feel. Oh, I hear him coming downstairs.
Now, we've got to be careful how we handle this, Herbert.
Very well, Pupsy.
Hello, Mrs. Anderson. Mr. Anderson, is dinner ready yet?
Dennis, I want to talk to you.
To me, Mrs. Anderson?
Yes. Do you know who you are, my boy?
Why, yes, ma'am. Offhand, I'd say I was me.
You're wrong. You're not you at all.
I'm not?
No.
Gee, then who was that bleeding when I cut myself shaving this morning?
Dennis, try to think. Do you remember your father?
Oh, sure. I met him through my mother.
Did he ever discuss with you what you'd be doing in your later life?
Well, let's see. I do remember my father saying he hoped I'd grow up.
Yes?
That's all.
Well, we'll try a new tack. Do you remember where you were born?
Well, Mother told me it was in a small town out west.
Wrong. You were born in New York City.
Oh, well, anyway, it was in 1926.
Wrong again. It was 1927.
In June?
November.
Gee, Mother didn't know much about me, did she?
Herbert, you try.
Yes, Poopsie. Now, Dennis, I want you to concentrate.
Yes, sir. On what?
Sardines.
Yes, sir.
Are you concentrating on sardines?
Yes, sir.
Good. Now tell me, who is your father?
A sardine?
Want it back again, Poopsie?
Yes. Dennis, I want you to think about your family. Your mother and father and your brother and sister.
I have a brother and sister?
Of course.
Gee, and that sneaky doctor never said a word to my mother about it.
Dennis, not only have you a brother and sister, but you have millions and millions of dollars in your own name.
Boy, my next letter home is sure going to be newsy, isn't it?
I give up. No, wait a minute. You know how loss of memory is always cured in the movies, a sudden blow on the head?
Yeah.
Hand me the fire tongs, Herbert.
Poopsie, no, you can't. We're not sure he is Schuyler Van Rensselaer.
So, if he's Dennis Day, have I lost anything?
No, Poopsie, there must be another way.
Yeah, please, Mrs. Anderson, it's none of my business what you do to somebody else's head, but let's not fool with it while I'm wearing it.
We'll continue this day in the life of Dennis Day in just a moment. Meanwhile, here's Dennis to sing his RCA Victor recording of Streets of Laredo.
I was just rambling through the streets of Laredo. Just another stranger that day on my way to anywhere. Wandering through the streets of Laredo. Those adobe walls so old turned to gold I saw there. She smiled at me passing by, and her eyes spent a moment with mine. Then all at once, I seems the view took a new kind of shine. Now we never will roam from the streets of Laredo. Never want to lose the spell, for here we fell in love.
Because of a transposed newspaper photograph, the Andersons are convinced that Dennis Day is really Schuyler Van Rensselaer suffering from amnesia. It's the following morning now, and after a rather trying breakfast, our confused young hero has arrived at his place of work, Don Juan Alvarez Espinosa's antique shop. Sam Jacoby, proprietor.
Oh, good morning, Mr. Jacoby.
Hello, honey boy. Hey, what's the matter there? Why are you looking all of a sudden like such a sad satchel?
Just that I'm all mixed up, Mr. Jacoby. I'm so confused, I don't know where I am.
Oh, for a minute you scared me there. I thought maybe you weren't yourself this morning.
That's just the trouble. Maybe I'm not.
What's this?
I said maybe I'm not myself at all. Maybe I'm somebody else.
Excuse me, could you try it again a little slower? Remember, as far as I'm concerned, you got an accent.
Heard me right, Mr. Jacoby. I said maybe I'm not Dennis Day.
Well, if you ain't Dennis Day, who are you?
Schuyler Van Rensselaer, the third.
The third? Who's on first?
Oh, it's nothing to joke about, Mr. Jacoby. I'm supposed to be Schuyler Van Rensselaer, the third, the heir to a sardine fortune.
Let me get this straight, honey boy. You just found out you ain't Dennis Day, the schnook at all. You're really Schuyler Van Rensselaer, the malted millionaire?
Yeah, isn't it awful?
Well, some days it goes like that, you know.
But Mrs. Anderson says I've got to recover my true identity. She wants me to go to a psychiatrist.
So what good is a foot doctor going to do you?
No, not a foot doctor. One of those fellows who puts you on a couch and explores your mind.
Oh, a pediatrician!
Yeah, that's it.
Oh, my wife's got a beauty. He's been exploring her brain for 6 months now and hasn't found a thing. I'll call Dr. Hopkins, right?
Gee, that's swell, Mr. Jacoby. And if I really turn out to be Schuyler Van Rensselaer, well, I promise you, you'll be up to your ears in sardines.
Hey, come in, my boy. Come right in. So you're the young man who thinks he's Dennis Day. That's your trouble, is it?
Yes, sir, and I've got it bad.
Yes. Well, we'll soon have you all straightened out. Now, suppose we get a little of your background right back to your infancy.
Yes, sir. Boy.
Yes, I know. Was there anything unusual or odd about your babyhood?
Well, half the time I couldn't see.
Couldn't see?
That's right. It was on account of my mother being so nearsighted.
Oh, heredity, huh?
No, sir. It was just that half the time she put the rubber pants on the wrong end of me.
I see. Perhaps we should take a somewhat later age. Say about the time you first became aware of girls.
I beg your pardon?
You realize there is an age at which young men become acutely aware of girls, don't you?
Oh, yes, sir, and I can hardly wait.
Obviously, schizophrenic.
Again, I would like to beg it?
Schizophrenic, split personality.
Oh.
You have submerged your true character, hard-drinking, woman-chasing Van Rensselaer, beneath the assumed character of Dennis Day, who is just the opposite. Do I make myself clear?
Oh, yes, sir. It's just that I don't know what you're talking about.
In other words, your amnesia is caused by an inner revulsion to your true self.
Ooh.
I can confirm my findings with a very simple test. Have you ever heard of word associations?
Oh, no, sir. But if they're anything like pyramid clubs, count me out.
I'm referring to a psychopathological test. Or to try and put it more understandably, neurasthenic.
You missed.
Yeah, well, in any event, I'll give you a word. Now, you're to tell me the word you associate with it. Ready?
Yes, sir.
All right. Black.
Black.
Black? I thought you'd say white.
Oh, we just met, Doctor. I don't want to start an argument with you.
It isn't an argument. It's a test. If I said boy, you'd say girl. Now, do you understand?
Yes, sir.
All right. Chair.
Thanks, but I've already got one.
Chair is the word. You're supposed to say table. What's the matter with you?
Oh, I'm sorry, sir.
I'll try it again, son.
Okay, try it again.
I am trying it again. Please listen, son.
I am listening, Pop.
Son is the word I gave you. You're supposed to tell me the word it makes you think of.
Oh, moon.
You finally understand what I mean. Are you ready now?
Yes, sir.
Good.
Bad.
That isn't the word!
I'm sorry.
I'll give you the word now. Table.
Pat Sullivan.
What has Pat Sullivan to do with table?
Oh, he's a fellow I used to know. He was always under it.
Well, so much for word association.
Yes, sir.
In fact, for tests of all kinds. Young man, there's only one practical treatment for your condition. Hypnosis.
Hypnosis?
Yes. If you will permit me to put you into an induced hypnotic trance, as distinguished from the one you're in now, I believe I can reactivate your subconscious and restore your identity.
You mean you're going to hypnotize me?
Exactly, if you'll permit it.
Well, there is a fortune waiting for me, I hear. Go ahead.
Very well. Now look deep into my eyes.
Yes, sir.
That's it. You're getting drowsy. Your senses are becoming numbed. You're falling asleep. Asleep. Sleep.
Hey, Doc, wake up.
Huh? Pardon me. Sometimes it goes into reverse. And look into my eyes again.
Yes, sir.
Deep into my eyes. You're growing drowsy, languorous. That's it. You're falling asleep. Sleep. Sleep. You're now in a hypnotic state. Listen to me. You are not Dennis Day.
I am not Dennis Day.
Your name is Schuyler Van Rensselaer.
My name is Schuyler Van Rensselaer.
You are... You're a playboy, mad about women.
I'm a playboy, mad about women.
You like to take a drink now and then. When you awaken, you will go home, but remember nothing of Dennis Day. You will be Schuyler Van Rensselaer, the playboy. And now, awaken.
O'clock and still no sign of him, Pupsy. Are you sure the boy's all right?
Of course he's all right, Herbert. Mr. Jacoby told me on the phone he'd send him to Dr. Hopkins, the psychiatrist.
And you really think he'll come back here thinking he's Schuyler Van Rensselaer?
I do.
Well, if I know Dennis, there's a much better chance that Dr. Hopkins will go back to Vienna thinking he's Dennis Day.
Oh, you're always fine. Oh,
that may be he. I'll go. Dennis!
The name is Schuyler, Shorty. Who are you?
Why, don't you know me? I'm Herbert Anderson.
Glad to meet you, Herbie. Is that all there is of you, or are you standing in a manhole?
My goodness gracious.
Oh, there you are, Dennis. You're back.
Hey, who's this character, Shorty? Your mother?
What?
Skip it, babe.
Babe? Why, you never called me anything but Mrs. Anderson in your life.
Well, don't crowd your luck. Well, how about a little drink, hey?
A drink? Of what?
Oh, who cares? I'm Schuyler Van Rensselaer, 5602 North Elm Street, and I've switched everything. Give me some Kentucky Tavern and leave the roof on.
Oh, my soul and body.
Mother, have you heard of it? Oh, there you are.
Well, hiya, baby. Let's neck. Come on, get your coat, kid. We'll go for a drive in the park.
I don't want to drive in the park.
Hey, look, babe, with me, you not only get to drive in the park, you get to park in the drive.
Mother, what's come over Dennis? Why, he's become a terrible ladies man.
Yes, sir. All I need now is a terrible lady. Hey, what do you say? I'll even take you up for a little spin in my private plane.
You will not.
Don't be jealous, Fatso. Tell you what. Tell you what, you get on your broom and we'll have a race, huh?
Oh, how could you be so awful? You ought to be ashamed.
Now, don't race your motor, Toots. I'm feeling give in if you're feeling give out.
Oh, you thief! Take this!
What? Mildred? Mrs. Anderson? What? Where am I?
Uh-oh, I think the enchanted hour is over.
Why, you're home, Dennis. What on earth happened to you?
Oh, gosh, I don't know. The last I remember, I was in Dr. Hopkins' office. He hypnotized me.
Hypnotized you? Then you're not Schuyler Van Rensselaer?
Oh, please don't start that again. I'm Dennis Day, Mrs. Aniston. Honest I am. Mildred, did I act funny?
I should say you did, and the things you had nerve enough to say to my mother.
Oh, my goodness. I'm going down to that doctor's office right now and tell him off plenty.
And I'm going with you, Dennis.
Are you
going
to tell him off too, Mr. Anderson?
No, sir. I'm going down for a treatment.
And now, here is a very important announcement. Want to win $49,000 in cash? That's right, $49,000 in cash. The first prize offered by the makers of Palmolive soap in their big, exciting 49 Gold Rush contest. Second prize, $4,900. And there are 4,949 other cash prizes. What a chance to win $100,000 in cash prizes, and it's easy to enter. Simply finish this sentence, I like Palmolive soap because, in 25 words or less, that's all. Just 25 words or less to finish the sentence, I like Palmolive soap because... Then mail your entry right away with a Palmolive soap wrapper. Easy, isn't it? And remember, thousands will strike it rich in the big 49 Gold Rush contest. Enter as often as you like. Get entry blanks and complete rules from your dealer, or send your entries on plain paper with your name and address and dealer's name and address, plus one Palmolive wrapper for each entry. Mail to Gold Rush Contest, Box 49, New York 8, New York. Better write that down. Gold Rush Contest, Box 49, New York 8, New York. Get Palmolive soap right away to help win a lovelier complexion and try for your share of the $100,000 in cash prizes. With the music of Charles Dant and the orchestra, here's Dennis to sing the popular ballad, So in Love.
Strange dear, but true. When I'm close to you, dear, the stars fill the sky. So in love with you am I, even without you.
Show him how much lovelier your hair can look after a Luster Cream shampoo. Only Luster Cream brings you Kay Dumit's Magic Blend. Glamorizes your hair as you wash it. Yes, tonight you can be a...
Dream girl, beautiful Luster Cream girl. You owe your crowning glory to a luster cream shampoo.
Listen again next week for Colgate's Hour of Fun, Judy Canova, followed by Dennis Day. And for another great comedy program, hear Blondie next Wednesday evening over your favorite NBC station. This is Vern Smith speaking. Good night.
February 19th, 1949, a day in the life of Dennis Day. On our Tuesday show, we'll have westerns, Frontier Town and Gunsmoke, and dramas, The Shadow and Casey Crime Photographer, and the ongoing situation with Lum and Abner. Speaking of which, we'll hear Lum and Abner coming up next.
A well-designed school can be more than a fine building and a place for learning. It can also protect the children, the teachers, and the whole neighborhood, too, if the architect has designed the school to serve as a community fallout shelter as well. Over 13,000 architects and engineers have been trained in fallout shielding techniques. To learn more about building fallout shelter into new schools, contact your local civil defense director.
And now on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox, let's see what's going on in Pine Ridge, Arkansas, as we check in with Lum and Abner in this episode from 82 years ago, February 19th, 1942.
The makers of Alka-Seltzer bring you Lum and Abner. You know, folks, I've got an idea that one of the main reasons why so many of you enjoy these regular radio visits with Lum and Abner is because folks down in Pine Ridge usually take things sort of slow and easy. So different from the life most of us are forced to live in this busy, exciting world these days. We hurry to work in the morning, we hurry through our day's work, we hurry through supper, and then if we're not too tired, we hurry out for the evening to get some relaxation. Well, it's no wonder that headaches, nervous indigestion, and other minor stomach upsets occasionally put us off our stride these days. Now, if you're one of those folks who are always on the go, I just hope for your sake that yours is an Alka-Seltzer home. For if you are Alka-Seltzer-wise, you already know how quickly and pleasantly it can ease your discomfort on those occasions when some common ache or pain causes distress. And if you don't know from experience how helpful Alka-Seltzer can be, take the word of the thousands who found out and try it. Take Alka-Seltzer for relief in occasional headaches, nervous indigestion, sour upset stomach, heartburn, muscular aches and pains, and morning after misery. You'll feel better fast. And now, let's see what's going on down in Pine Ridge. Well, everyone in Pine Ridge is still going out of his way to be honest, kind, and generous in an effort to win the $10,000 that Diogenes Smith is offering to the town's most model citizen. However, little has been seen of Diogenes lately, as he's been working late at night printing his pamphlets in the workshop, which the old fellows fixed up for him in the feed room. As we look in on the little community today, we find Abner in the jot-em-down store and library. Lum has just returned from his pamphlet-delivering duties. Listen.
Granny, I'll be glad when the 3 months of this honesty contest is over.
Me, too.
Yeah, I wore a blister big as a hen's egg on my right foot, tramping all over town with these pamphlets on right living and stuff.
Yeah, I seen you sort of limping when you come in just now.
Yeah, and that ain't the worst of it, neither. When I get over near the schoolhouse, the young'uns follow me around and holler out stuff about me being a deliver boy.
Well?
It's embarrassing, that's what it is. Downright embarrassing.
Yeah, well, now, I'll be proud to take over your work for you, Lum, if you want me to, and hand out the pamphlets for a while.
No. Diogenes finding me to do this job, and I can't let him down. I gotta show him how helpful and trustworthy I am.
Yeah, well, if you got blisters on your feet, though, Lama, you ought not to be out walking.
No, I can handle it all right, Abner. Besides, you got enough work to do right here now. Well, when did all them get here?
Huh?
All them canned goods there.
Oh, the truck from the wholesale house just brung them out about half an hour ago. I was just getting ready to stack them up in the shelves.
Well, I'll do that, long as I'm back now. You just sit there and take it easy.
Why, no, I'll do it myself, Lum. Now, you sit down and rest your feet.
No, this ain't no work for you, Abner. I'm taller and I can reach up better. It's too strenuous for you. I'll stack up the cans.
No, sir, now, you got blisters on your feet, Lum.
It don't matter how many blisters I got. I'm always willing to keep going and lend the helping hand to my feller man.
Well, what are you talking so loud for? Oh, Diogenes can't hear you back there in the feed room, Lum. Not the way he's got that door boarded up.
How do you know he can't?
I done ask him.
Well, I'll stack up the cans anyway. He might be able to hear me.
Well, now wait now, Lum. Just leave him alone. I'll get away. I'll stack up.
Hello, Mr. Lum, Mr. Abner.
Oh, howdy, Cedric. A dog, as you sneaked in here awful quiet.
Well, I have to. See, I lost the little cap off my lantern, so now I have to walk quiet so I won't spill the coal oil out of it.
Well, why don't you just stick a potato there where the cap's supposed to be? That'll keep the coal oil in.
No, Mom, that wouldn't look very good. Wouldn't be neat.
Well,
I don't see what you have to carry that lantern around for anyway, Cedric.
Mr. Dodge needs carries one. That's who I want to be like when I grow up.
Grow up? Why, you're already bigger than he is right now, Cedric. Why, sure you are. What was it you wanted when you come in, Cedric?
Oh, nothing. I just dropped in to... Or no, wait a minute. I'm supposed to deliver a message from Mr. Diogenes.
From Diogenes?
Yes, Mom. He wants to see Mr. Lum about something private, he said.
Oh.
Something private? Hey, Granny, did you hear that, Abner?
Uh-huh.
Whereabouts does he want to see me, Cedric? In the feed room? Or, I mean, his printing shop?
No, Mom. Just go around to the side of the store there. He's waiting there for you. So you better hurry up, Mr. Lum.
I'm practical there right now. Something private, huh? Just leave them cans, Abner. I'll stack them up soon as I get back.
No, I'll tend to it myself now. Cedric, what does Diogenes want Lum for?
I don't know, sir.
Oh, come on now, Cedric. Tell me.
Honest, I don't know, Mr. Abner. Mr. Diogenes never told me a thing. Just said he wanted to see him.
No, because I'd give my right arm to know what he's telling that Lum. Bound you something about me is about what it is. Or maybe he wants Lum to help him run that printing press back there. That'd be worse than ever, having that Lum that close to Diogenes all the time.
I don't think that's what it is, Mr. Abner. I don't believe.
You don't, huh?
No, I know Mr. Diogenes don't want nobody to help him do the printing. He said he felt more inspired when he done the work all by himself.
When did he say all that?
Last night, long about 1 or 2 o'clock.
1 or 2? Doggies, what was you doing up at that time of the night, Cedric?
Oh, me and the Macmillan boys had went out coon hunting, and we was just getting back to town, and I seen a light back there in the feed room, and I got to feeling sorrowful for Mr. Dodge, and he's having to work so long.
Well, that was thoughty of you.
So I went up and opened the back door to the feed room, and you know what? I nearly scared the daylights out of him.
Scared him?
Yes, Mom, he jumped 116 feet. His face sort of turned white. Boy.
Well, naturally, a feller would get scared that-a-way, Cedric. You are to knock before you open the door that-a-way.
Yes, Mom.
That ain't polite the way you done that, Cedric, no.
No, Mom. Reckon why he has to work such long hours that-a-way, though.
Well, I think I know, Cedric. I hate to admit to it, but it's all on account of me, I'm feared.
On account of you?
Yeah. You recollect how he got mad at me for turning in them IDs for pamphlets that Lum writ the other day and claiming them for my own?
Yes, Mom, I recollect.
Well, he taken that pamphlet writing job away from me, so now, naturally, he has to do all the writing himself. And then he has to do the printing, too, so I reckon that just makes him stay up late of a night to do the printing. But don't you tell Lum none of this.
No, Mom, I ain't going to say nothing to nobody.
Lum still thinks I'm in awful good with Diogenes. He'll do might not anything I ask him to do now. He figures I'll make good reports about him to Diogenes.
Well, are you going to make a good report?
Why, of course not. I don't make no reports of no kind. But I want to keep him thinking I do. I think it makes old Lum sort of jealous, too.
Yes, well. Say, Mr. Abner, can you see anything on my face?
On your face? Let's see. Why, no, I can't see a thing, Cedric. You ain't expecting to get the measles or nothing, are you?
No, Mom. Look closer.
Can't you see no whiskers?
Whiskers? Oh, of course not. Just that fuzz on your chin, though.
Doggone it anyway. I've rubbed 6 bottles of hair tonic on my face just so's I could grow me a beard like Mr. Dodge needs and win that $10,000 prize.
Well, you won't win it growing no beard, Cedric. I can tell you that right now.
Yes, Mom, I believe I will. I know Mr. Dodge and he says the way to win it was to be just like him, and he's got a beard, too.
Well, he never meant you ought to look like him, Cedric. He meant you ought to act like he does, be kind and honest and lend a helping hand and follow all the things that he says to do.
Well, I've been doing that, too.
Well, that's what he means. You don't have to look like him. You couldn't look. Wait a minute. Here comes old Lum back.
Mom?
Oh, he must have got some good news. Yeah, I can tell by the way he's walking. Look at that big smile on his face.
Yes, I mean, he's in a good humor with himself.
Oh, yeah. I doggy, that walk means he's got a big idea, too, I'm feared. I don't like that, Cedric.
You mind if I look around the store and see if I lost a cap off my lantern in here someplace?
No, go right ahead, Cedric.
I won't bother nothing.
No, go right ahead. Well, what Diogenes want, Lum?
Oh, nothing. Secret stuff.
What secret stuff?
Oh, I ain't allowed to tell you, Abner.
Huh?
I will tell you this, though. I ain't no deliver boy no more.
No deliver boy?
No, sir. I've been promoted to circulating manager. What do you think of that?
Circulating manager?
Yes, sir. You ain't the only ones in good with Diogenes.
Well, what's a circulating manager supposed to do?
Oh, he's a feller that sees that the pamphlets get sent out to all the other towns in the country. Spread the word of honesty into all the darkened corners of the universe.
Oh.
Wish I could say that like he does. Say, Abner, we got any red ribbon in the store here?
Red ribbon?
Yeah.
Doggy, you don't have to wear ribbons to be a circulating manager, do you?
Of course not.
Well, I was gonna say, I wouldn't want to be one of them.
Well, this ain't got to be worn in my hair. I just want a little piece to put in my coat lapel, so's a feller will recognize me when I get to the county seat.
What feller?
I can't tell you, Abner. Secrets.
Huh?
All I can let you know is that I'm making a secret trip to deliver a whole package of honesty pamphlets to a certain feller. But I can't tell you where I'm going.
Oh. Well, where's this feller from that you're going to meet in there at the county seat?
County seat?
Yeah.
Wait a minute. How'd you know that?
Huh?
Now, Grannies, was you spying on us? Eavesdropping, huh?
I weren't no such a thing spying. You said that yourself just now. Honest, you did.
I did, huh?
Why, sure.
Grannies, I got to watch myself. First thing I know, I'll be blabbing everything Dodge and East told me. Even the secret password.
Secret password?
Yeah. Light the lantern, friend. Then if I got the right feller, he answers, the lantern's lit. But that's something I can't tell you.
Oh, come on, tell me, Long.
No, the password's a secret, Abner. I can't tell you or nobody else what it is.
Please tell me. Honest, I won't tell it to nobody
else. No, I promised Dodge and Ease I wouldn't.
Oh, Dad, blame it.
Besides, if I told you, you'd just run and make a report to Dodge and Ease about me breaking my promise. I might tell you if you wasn't one of them deputies. You are a deputy, ain't you?
Well, I ain't allowed to say, Lum.
Yeah, I know. Listen, Abner, will you tell me whether you're one if I tell you whether I'm one or not?
Well, I reckon if both of us tell, why, it's all right. You better not let Cedric hear so.
No, better just whisper.
Yeah.
I ain't one.
Well, I ain't neither.
You ain't?
No.
Well, my granny, you sure been acting like one. You've been acting awful suspicious.
Why, I never done it. You the one that's acting suspicious.
No, sir, it was you.
Ah.
To think I wasted all my being nice and kind stuff on you. Granny's ought to know better.
Well, I was awful nice to you, too. Don't forget that.
You made me believe you was one, just so's I'd be nice to you and do the work around here.
I never done no such a thing.
I never noticed you doing nothing to make me like you any better.
Well, I was going to stack all them canned goods up for you just now.
For me?
Yes, sir.
Well, that's your work.
Huh?
Go ahead and get them up there in the shelf.
Well, I ain't going to do no such a thing. You got to do that yourself, Lum.
Why,
you ought to do a little work around here.
All right.
I'll do your work, Lum. I'll do my work, too. I'll do all the work around here. Wonderful world, Diogenes.
Oh, wonderful world, Diogenes.
Say, folks, how many times you heard someone say, "Oh, for the good old days." Well, I wonder, were the good old days so good after all? How would you like, for example, to have to go back to the old-fashioned kitchen cure methods of relieving cold distress, now that the modern Alka-Seltzer way has proven to be so pleasant and effective? You know, until you've tried it, you have no idea how quickly and how pleasantly Alka-Seltzer offers relief for that aching head and that dull, ache-all-over, feverish feeling of a cold. You'll want to use it as a gargle, too, for your sore, raspy throat due to the cold. So be modern, folks, and be wise. The next time you catch a cold, take common sense precautions. Get more rest than usual, watch your diet, dress sensibly, and take Alka-Seltzer. See how much better it makes you feel. Remember, you can get Alka-Seltzer at all drugstores.
Wonderful World, Lum and Abner, from 82 years ago, February 19th, 1942, here on Classic Radio Theater with Wyatt Cox. Have yourself a great Monday. On Tuesday's show, Westerns, Frontier Town, and Gunsmoke, crime dramas, The Shadow, and Casey Crime Photographer, and another episode of Lum and Abner. Visit our webpage, classicradio.stream, and we'll see you on Tuesday. Have yourself a great day.